All right, welcome back to EC 520. Today, first, I'm going to go over some of the questions I got from you guys. First one was the incorrect link on the lab assignment. So if you go to lab one, double check. Yes, go to lab one. Why this jumps? Go to lab one, and then this link was incorrect. So when you were clicking on it, it was taking you to an empty template GitHub repo. Now, the way it works is if you look at the requirements of the lab, here it states that you need to install all these requirements, so make sure you just follow the videos and on YouTube channel and install all the requirements, including make, CMake, everything. So I assume most of you guys are on Windows. That's why I provide you with the installation guide on Windows. The Linux part is very straightforward. You just need to make sure you have Clang installed or GCC installed, Git, and you need to set up your Git account, Git SSH connection, and so on. You don't need to go through all these pains of installing msys2, and then mingjw, Clang format, CMake from the mingjw, and so on. But since most of you are on Windows, we are going to cover Windows part of it. Make sure to install the Pico SDK and Vivaldi and Vitis. Now, when you're done, you need to complete this lab, which basically proves that you have set up your environment correctly. And this is a very just rudimentary assignment. It's basically hello world in C and C++. One is printf, one is the C out. Very straightforward. Now, when you go to the GitHub account, if you click on this link, you need to have a GitHub account first, basically be logged into your GitHub account, and then you will see something like this, accept the assignment. So make sure to accept the assignment first. And then first, it will give you some blank page like this. But if you refresh the page, you should get a link. If you click on the link will take you to the actual GitHub assignment here. So if you look at here, there's a hello world that you have to complete. And basically here, if you look at here, there's a main.c. And there's a README file that is asking you to only change the main.c. Use the printf to print a message, and the message is exactly this, basically hello world in C, and this is a new line, right? This is a long break in C. So you just basically write a printf to print this statement, and then you need to basically run the make file to build this assignment, and then you can run it yourself, or you can run the make test to test it. So I will explain what I mean by these. So this is a make file. It's just a very simple make file that when you run it, if you run Clang, so to make sure it Clang is installed on your machine, we'll look for the main.c, and then it will create an output called main, a binary file called main that you can execute, then executes that file. Basically, that's all it does. Now, if you type main make test, it will again run the Clang main.c, but the output in this time it would be test, just for testing purposes. And then we'll execute this test.sh. So this file is not the same as this. This is your C compiled C code. This is your binary C code. And this is a bash script. So if you go back to here and look at this, this is a bash script that we are going to actually learn how to code in bash, but it will just print this message, and then it will look for it will have this variable called output, and then it will execute this binary file that you made, and then will capture its output. Then what it does, it just looks for this hello world.c in it. And if the file doesn't exist, if there's any error executing this thing, it will just fail. Otherwise, it will say pass. Basically, file was executed. Secondly, it's going to look for this output. That's the only thing that it expects. And if it finds it in your output, it was going to say it's pass. Otherwise, it's going to say it's failed. And then it's going to print the result and exit. Now, if you go to the back to main dot main file, make file, there's one called clean. And if you want to, for example, remove all your artifacts like test or main that you created by running this code, this make, this will remove any of those if they exist in the current folder. Now, to get more technical, if you want to learn how to do this, there on GitHub, there is a service that they provide. It's called Actions. And in the Actions, when you submit something, they are going to read a configuration file that you can actually, it will just, it's like a continuous integration. Basically, you submit your code and then you have set of instructions for the GitHub server to execute to test your submission. And it could be anything. It could be from running your unit test, from checking if file exists, from checking if all the requirements are there, or checking if there is any major differences between the two files, versions that you submitted, and so on. You can write as many things as you like. It's very flexible. Now, how can you set up this? If you go back, you can look at the settings here. If you look at the GitHub.github here, is in this format in Linux, anything that comes starts with the dot is a hidden file. So if you clone this on a Linux machine and you just run a simple list or ls command on Linux, you won't see this folder. But if you type ls-a or all, it will just list all the files, including the hidden ones. Now, if you go to here, there's something called workflows, and there's a YAML file. A YAML file, we are going to talk about these. It's similar to like a XML or JSON, but with a very simpler structure. Basically, everything is a space format like Python. So it has a name, and then it has a bunch of commands like start executing. It sets the permission of the files that it's going to generate. So write and read are added. And then jobs are things that it's going to do. Basically, it's going to name it auto grading action. You can name it whatever you like. So this auto grading action will show up here. If you go to actions that they run, if you expand one of these, you see here this auto grading action that you see here, this name is actually defined by me as a developer that will show up there. And then first thing is going to define the container or the OS that it's going to run on. So it's going to get Ubuntu latest. If you're familiar with Docker and container-based applications, this is basically the same idea. It's going to spawn or start a container running Ubuntu and latest Ubuntu. So, and then it's going to basically clone or install a bunch of applications. Like one is this action checkout, which is used for GitHub itself. Then it's going to install Clang version 1.4. Then it's going to update the Ubuntu. And then it's going to install this library, which is not needed anymore for this homework, but I should take it out. This is called libcriterion. This is the old test library that I was using for testing this. Later on, I changed it to bash. And then after that, it's going to just execute the created directory here called classroom, and then auto-grade this thing by running the tests. So that's a GitHub action. So I just went over this so you guys will have for advanced people who have some background in GitHub or in CI, continuous integration. So you would have some background. I know some people are not, maybe this is just too much, but bear with me. I need to cover a lot of different skills in this class. So now you got the idea. Let's clone this thing and let's do it together. So to clone the GitHub, you need to go to code, and then you can either choose the HTTPS or SSH, or if you install GitHub CLI, do this, use CLI. So CLI is basically a shorter version of the regular Git commands. I usually don't use it because if you get too hung into GitHub CLI and you go to other repository providers like GitLab, they're not using the this is just specific to GitHub. So if you get too accustomed to this, you might not be able to use other platforms. But the regular Git commands like git clone, git add, git commit, these are just standards. You can use them everywhere. So make sure to set up your SSH as it was specified, SSH key as it was specified in the videos. If you don't do that, you're going to get into troubles when you submit the code to the GitHub. So since I have set up my SSH, I'm not going to cover it because it's in the videos, in the YouTube videos. So I'm going to clone this and I go to any place that I like to work on. So you can use Git Bash terminal, or you can use your VS Code terminal. So VS Code comes with the terminal. If you press Control tilde, it will open a terminal for you. Now, a few things about the VS Code terminal. If you open it, there's an option here that will give you all the possible terminals you can have on VS Code. So one is the Git Bash, which you install. You might have msys2. There's a PowerShell, which comes from Windows itself. It's a JavaScript debug terminal for some reason here, and so on. So I'm going to use Git Bash, or there's one command prompt. So you need to make sure you are using Git Bash for your assignments. Don't go to PowerShell or command prompt. So I'm on the Git Bash now. Then be organized. So choose a place for your assignments. So for this reason, I'm going to use my documents. And one thing when you're in the Bash terminal is the best thing that is your best friend, basically. The thing that makes your life much easier is the tab completion. So if you type a folder, for example, or a command that can be completed, and the Bash script can, the Bash terminal can figure it out, you can try it by typing tab. So if I type the first four letters of the folder, I want to change directory. So CD stands for change directory in Linux. So I want to go to that folder. I type docu and tab, and it completes it. I don't need to type all the way like documents, and then I make a mistake, and then maybe I have something wrong there. I just type du doc and then tab, it completes. Now, if you have multiple options, like if I type do and tab, I need to press twice. So if I just type once, it will not move forward. But if I type twice, it gives me two options. It tells me you have documents and downloads. Which one do you want to choose? So you can say DOC and documents. Now you change the folder to documents. Next is I'm going to create a folder here. I already have it. So I'm going to go to the work folder. Let me get this out of the way. Now here, I can create a folder in where I want to work on. So you can create a folder in Linux by typing make mkdir. Mkdir stands for make directory in Linux. I'm going to create a directory and let's name it hello world exercise one. And then now I created that folder. I can check if that exists by typing ls. So ls in Linux stands for list. So you can list the folders by typing ls, and it will give you all the folders that you have in this repository, in this directory. As you can see, I have a lot of them. It's kind of hard to see what I have. There's a better format of this. You can type ls-la. Right now, I'm just seeing the name of the folders, and I'm not seeing any hidden folders. But if I type ls-la, I'm going to get the entire list with the extra information, what the permission on that folder is, who's the owner of it, and the date that it was modified, and so on. So, and the size of it, if it's a file. So now I see them, but still it's a long list. I have to look into it to see if I can find whatever I created. So another trick to make it easier for you to figure out if the file was created, you can just type ls-la, and then with T for sorting the files based on the time it was created. But if you just put T, it would be chronological. Basically, from the first one that was created the first one that was the newest one on the top, and the latest one, the one that was the oldest one at the bottom. If I run this, I still, oh, actually this is LSL. Yep. So this is, let me run it. As you can see here, this is just showing me the oldest one on the bottom, which is in 2023. And the newest one that which I created is on the top. So, okay, I saw my folder is created, but I still have to use my mouse and then scroll up and look at for that one. So instead of doing it, I can reverse this. Basically, put the oldest on the top, newest one at the bottom. So you can add an R either in front of the T or before T, it doesn't matter. This will reverse the list. So now I have my newest folder that I created at the bottom of this. This way I can just quickly find it. That's one trick. Another way to do this, you don't need to even list it. You can just type pipe. This is a command. This is a syntax in Linux, that in Bash or a shell script in Linux, that will pass the output of the previous command to the next command. That's why this is called pipe. Basically, whatever is the output of this, it's going to be passed to the next command that you have. Now in Linux, there is a command called grep. And grep allows you to search for specific patterns in your the string that you have. You can look for, it's like a search string, but really powerful. You can search for a string inside your content of your files. We will get into the Linux commands, but for now, to get you started, I'm just giving you the basics so you can start working on the exercises. So I can type grep and then exercise dash one. I'm just going to look for exercise dash one. If I run that, it will only return the one that has exercise dash one in it, nothing else. Now in Linux, most of the time you're going to be at the bottom of the screen because you might have a lot of things on the top. So to clear the string, you have two options. Option one, you can type clear, and it will clear the string, the screen that you have. But that's kind of too much typing, right? You want to always shorten everything. So another trick is you can type Control L, and that will also clear your screen. One thing that you will see is that this is not actually clearing your screen. You still have your buffer there on the top. It just jumps to the start top of the string and then top of it, the screen that you have, and then rest of the buffers will be behind the first line. So you still have access to those. You didn't lose it, but now your cursor is on the top. Okay, let's change the directory to the hello world. And you see here, I have two of those, exercise one. Now I have hello world exercise one. From here, I can type git clone. And if you're not familiar with Git, Git is basically a repository of codes that you write, and you can host it on a remote location. Now, if you want to clone it and pull it down into your local computer, this is the command. You type git clone, and in this terminal, you have to press shift insert to paste it. There's no control C, control V here. On Linux is different, but here in Windows, it's shift insert. So I put the address of the Git repo that I accepted as my homework. And if I run it, if I have the correct SSH setup for my GitHub, I should be able to see this. Basically just getting all the information I wanted, the file that I asked. And if I look at here, this is my exercise. Now, if I change my directory to here by typing CD, now I can type ls-la. And then these are the files that I need to work on. So when you are in Visual Studio Code, you can always open a file by typing code and the address of the code. For example, in this one, if I type 001 and then main.c, let's see what was the name of it. It was main.c. If you type code and press enter, you should be able to get to the actual file that you want to work. So what you want to do is you want to minimize hand moving your hand from keyboard to the mouse. So this way you're going to be more efficient when you type code. You don't want to keep going back and forth with mouse and then going. A lot of people do it, but it's not efficient. Oh, a few other things, tricks on Visual Studio Code. You can, when you install Visual Studio Code, usually your file explorer is going to be on the right, on the left. But the problem is when you expand this from the left, open and close it, it will push your code back and forth. So I don't like that. So I usually put my explorer on the right so I can just edit or remove it. You see here, my code doesn't move from left to right. I think this is a better option. It might be awkward when you start working with it, but you will get used to it and you will love it. So, okay, the only thing I need to do is I need to write printf. The rest of this stuff is written. I have the correct library here. So printf, and then I need to type hello world and backslash n. Now, a few things is if you write the incorrect text here, your test is not going to pass. So I write hello world, but is that the required text? So I need to check, like, right? So if I go to this folder, and if I type, if I open the README by typing code README. So this is a markdown down syntax. So in Git or many documentation tools, you can write a markdown syntax. And it's very straightforward. It's very simple. It's just 5 or 6 syntax that you need to know. So if you put one hash in front of your text, it would be just title, the largest title you can get. If you put 2 hashes, it would be title 1 level smaller. And if you put 3, it would be 2 levels smaller, and then so on. So right now, you're not seeing any formatting here. But if you go to GitHub, and if you go to, for example, here, this is how it looks like. So this is H1, which is the largest header you get. And then this is H3 and H3. And this is just a regular text here. This is a bullet point. How can you create a bullet point in Markdown? You create it by putting dashes in front of your text. Now, if you have a code that you want to highlight, you put them in the ticks here. Now, let's say I don't want to jump back and forth between the GitHub and so on. Some people are comfortable reading Markdown just because it's a human readable. It's not formatted, but it's still human readable. But VS Code comes with this option. Basically, if you click on this icon here, it will show you the formatted version of this. Basically, now this is what you actually see on the actual webs, in the browser. Okay. So the requirement is to write hello world with the small lowercase w in C and then line break. So line break basically means that go to the next line after you print this statement. Okay, so I can use that. I'm going to just print it here. And now I can build this application, right? This program that I wrote. So to run it, I can type make. Now a few things. If you're on Linux, you can just type make and you're done. If you install WSL, you're still in Linux environment, you can write make. But if you are on Windows, which I am now, just typing make won't work because make by itself is going to build this application for Windows, native Windows application, and you are going to get into all sorts of problems. So you have to actually write this whole thing, basically exact address to your make file, basically your msys2 folder, minggw64 bin, and then minggw32-make. That's the make file that you're going to execute. So this is a long path and I can't remember it. I can't memorize it. I don't have enough memory cells to memorize this kind of stuff. So to make it easier for yourself, you can create aliases in Linux. How can you create any alias? So if you open your bash RC, so if I open my bash RC, you have to be in the bash git bash terminal to be doing to be able to do this. If you're using other terminals, unfortunately, Windows is kind of weird development environment. So it's going to have its own containered environment for Linux. You might have a different bash RC somewhere else. You change that, it won't have any effect here. So you need to make sure you're in the correct shell. So if I look for my bash, you see here, I have bash profile and bash RC. Let's see, where did I put that? So I put it in the, my bash RC. So these are the aliases that I wrote. So if you don't know what is alias, alias means that it's like a pseudonym, a name that you can use as your other name. Maybe your name is too long, you come up with a shorter name. Maybe your name is like, for example, Jonathan, and then it's hard to say. People say, okay, John, right? So it's the same idea. So instead of having like C and hold this path, I can just type make, but I have to define it. You think that you will learn when you're working with these old script structures is that you have to pay very close attention to how this thing is written. So in Linux, in the bash Linux, when you create a variable, you cannot have space. So if I put space here, this is incorrect. Although this is fine in C, it's fine in Python, but in bash, if you do that, it's going to crash. It's not going to actually work. So you can't have space between your equal sign and your variable name and the value you put in it. Now, the way you define it, you type alias here, and then the path to the make a binary file that you want to execute. So now I have my make here. Also for the CMake on Windows, this is the syntax you have to run. So it's not CMake by itself. CMake and then dash G, which is the actually builder that you're going to use for building CMake. We haven't gotten into CMake yet, but CMake itself is not a build tool. CMake is just generates a set of make files that you have to, again, use make for building it. So it doesn't only generate for make, it generates for other build tools like Ninja and other sorts of build tools. So you have to specify what kind of output CMake has to create. So dash G, that's a generator. And then min-gw make files are the targeted output of the CMake. I know I'm giving you a lot of information, but that's why I was asking you to prepare and be ready for these technical information. Okay, now a few other things. If you remember when I was just writing a list, I was typing ls-la. So you can simplify that. I'm a lazy person. I don't want to just keep typing a lot of keywords. Life is short. I made all those things into one single letter, L. And if I want to change directory to the parent directory, instead of typing cd dot dot, I type C. If I want to see the list of commands that I ran in the past, I can type history, but that's too long. I can type H. If I want to exit a terminal, I can type E instead of typing exit, and so on. Even for the PuTTY, when we get into PuTTY, you can just basically load the PuTTY by, for example, making it a alias like this. We will get to that. Okay, I'm gonna get out of my Vim. So if I type alias now, I will see the list of the aliases I have. Now, since I have the shorthand for make, I can type make. So one thing you should note is that when you create anything in the shell, you have to source it first, or you have to close the shell and open it. If you're a Linux person, you usually don't close your shell. You just type source and then your bash rc, and then now everything is in place. Now you can just run it. One thing to remember about bash and shell is that when there is no output, no news, it's good news. So if you don't see any output, basically it means that most of the time, it means that your command ran correctly. If you see any error or message it, you have to pay attention. So, okay, so this ran. So from here, I can just type make. I have to make sure I'm in the correct folder. So I am in the 001 hello world in C. I can type make and it will, okay, few things to remember. Use one of the followings, make run. Okay, when I run make, I have three commands here, make run, make test, and make clean. Where are they coming from? We actually defined it. So if you open the code. Code make files. Here you see here I defined a command called run, command called test, and a command called clean. So there's, since there's no default for these, I have to choose between the run, test, or clean. So I'm going to choose make run. I run make run. And this, as you can see here, it's running the Clang compiler using main.c-o main. And then it executes the main file that I created. And then I get the hello world in C as expected. If I look at the generated files, now I see this main.exe, which is a Windows format. And that's the artifact that is created. I want to remove it. I can type rm and main.exe. I can remove it, but I don't need to. I can type make clean. If I do that, now it runs the rm for remove in Linux. Now, if I look at it, it's gone now. Okay, let's say I want to test my code. I can type make test and then press enter. This will run the command, these commands, basically Clang to build my application, create an output called test, and then run that bash script that I showed you for testing it. It's printing this message and then checking if the program was executed correctly, and it will check the output is correct. If you see this, basically the result is all tests passed. Let's say I have some errors. If I go to here and then maybe I just miss hello world in only. If I look at the output here, you see the test.exe is generated. I don't need to remove it. You can just type again, make test one more time. And then this time it's going to say, expected hello world in C, but got hello world in. So that's an error. I can go ahead and fix it. C backslash n. And now if I type make test, it runs and all tests passed. Okay, let's say I'm done. I want to add this code to my repository so it can be graded and it can be recorded. So I type git status. So when you push any code, before pushing any code to the GitHub, you need to see which files have changed. And if that's the correct file that you want to push, you don't want to just blindly push the whole set of files into your GitHub repo. So usually type git status. Now, if I type git status, I see that this file has changed. But if you have multiple files in the folder change, it won't give you the list. It will give you only the folder name. So to make the code, the output of the git status just more verbose, you can put dash u. So you run that and usually get used to running git status dash u. That's a better syntax because you see the entire files that you're pushing. So I see that main.c has changed, but I don't know what has changed in it. I can type git diff to see what has changed. As you can see, this is a C, this is a git format. It is telling me that you had a blank line with the minus, which was deleted. And then this printf hello world was added. So that's the only change I had in this file. So if you have many, many changes, they will show up like this. Something you added, something you removed. And they will be on top of each other. There are other ways to make this more prettier, but that's a diff, or difference between the two versions of Git. The first version, which is this one, and the new version that we're working on. Okay, now that I know what has changed and I'm satisfied, I can add this to my GitHub database. Now, we haven't talked about GitHub, but maybe we should set a workshop to do that. But in a nutshell, whenever you start working with Git, what you need, these are the steps that you go through. Basically, you clone first, or you initialize your GitHub. Second, you need to make your changes, whatever you do, your project. Now you have to tell the Git that you have done some changes. Basically, Git, when you start, it just keeps track of, doesn't keep track of your changes. It just looks at your code, but it's benign. It's not going to intervene or record anything. It's in its database. So to tell Git that you have actually made some changes that you want to keep track of, you type git add. And then you can just be very specific. You can say, just add the main.c that I made or I changed it. That's one way. But if you are you have a lot of files, you don't need to list them one at a time. You can just say the folder that they are in. So usually people type git add dot to saying that record all the files that change in the current folder, in the current directory, which is this directory. And so I do that. Now, if you look at the output here in this git add, let me see if I ran the git add, git status. Now, if I type git status now, the dash u, I see that now Git is saying that you modified this file and it's staged. Basically, Git is now keeping track of it. But keeping track doesn't mean that Git actually saved it. It's in its own database. So Git has a hidden database that keeps track of all the changes that you have in the hash format, hash table. We're not getting into those discussions. But for now, you just know that Git is just telling you that, okay, you told me that you have made some changes in the main.c, and I'm just keeping an eye on it. Any questions? Yeah, just go ahead.
Professor, like yes. After modifying the changes, so to which branch we need to push the code?
Okay, good question. So you see here, this is the main branch. So this is called the main branch. So you just stay on the main branch. We're not creating a different branch.
Oh, okay, fine. Okay, thanks, Professor.
We get to the branches soon. Okay, so this is a main.c that I made a change and I'm keeping track of it. I told the Git that I changed, made the changes, but now I want to record this in the Git database. So to record a change, basically saying that I'm done with the development, now put a stop on all the changes I made and record this in your database so I can recall it in the future. It's like you're done with your development. You press Control S, and then you close everything, you go home, and then next day you come to your development desk, and then you open your browser or IDE, and then you open from where you left. You can start from there right away, right? That's the same idea. But in that format, you cannot go in the past, but in Git, you can actually go steps in the past also. So I will show you how it looks like. So to save your changes in Git database, the command is git commit dash m, and then git commit is the full command. Now, if you press on this, just git commit, it will open a text editor. It usually is a Vim, depending on what you chose. You can change it to VS Code or whatever you have. And it will ask you to put a commit message. And that message is going to be shown on the GitHub, and then it will be a record for the future people who want to read the changes you made in your code. So to make it simpler, you can usually just put a short message and type git m, and then you can put a 50 character max. Usually it's recommended to put 50 character maximum, 50 or 80 characters. You can start with your username, GitHub username if you like. So these are some recommendations. It depends on your work, and your company's convention for repository tracking or for code tracking, basically. So put a message here. You can start with your username. That's a good thing because people will know that you are the one that actually made it. They can see it in GitHub. But if you don't put it, it doesn't matter. You can put anything here. But usually it's recommended to put a meaningful message here. You can say completed hello world in C, right? That's my message. And I press git commit. When I do that, a new hash is created. Basically now this information is recorded in the database with this keyword, this key. So this key is telling the Git that this is the end of this. And then you can come back to this whenever you like. Now, if I type git log, I will see all the changes that had been done on this. So this was the initial design, and then it went all the way, and this is the new one that I made. So now this is a commit that I put. This is the name of it, the developer, the author is my username. This is my email address, the date it had been done, and this is the hash. So hash is a long text, but you don't need to type the whole hash to go to this commit. You can put the like one or two characters, and then four or five characters is enough to jump from the between the commits. So if you go to the, for example, this commit, you can jump to this commit or this commit. This is like a time machine. You can go back in the time and see what had been done to this code. Now that you have that, the last thing you need to do is to push this to the GitHub. You type git push origin, and then the name of the branch you want to push it. What is a branch? We will get to that. But this is a branch that I'm pushing this code to it. Now, right now, if I go to my GitHub, I haven't pushed it yet, right? If I go to my main.c, I see nothing here, right? It has not been pushed there yet. Now, if I do that, git push origin. Now, if everything is set up, you should see this, and then saying that main had been pushed, the local main had been pushed to the remote main. Now, if I come here and refresh my page, I will see my printf here. Now, a few things you should pay attention is the action tab here in GitHub. If you go here, you see here, this is just running the tests on my code. So it's saying that it's running the test, basically just spawning the container, Ubuntu container, and then running the tests, installed Clang, installed the unit tests here, and then writing results, and then ran the first test, which was my hello world here. And then it says failed, right? Why it failed? The first test passed because I fixed it. The second test didn't pass because I didn't fix it. So there's nothing in it. This is for C++. And then that one failed. And this is the grade I got. So each of them had 50 points. So I got 50 out of 100. So this is the grade that we are going to put on your Canvas. That's how you can make sense of it. I hope this is clear to you guys. You got the idea of what we're doing here. Next thing is so I'm sure that you now can finish the other one, right? So if you go to 002 and you look at your code main.cpp, this is exactly the same thing, but this time it's using C++. So in C++, don't add like stdio and so on. We are not going to use printf. Please use cout. So you should note that in C++ you have something called the standard library. So standard std namespace, you need to include that, and then you need to type cout, and the command is cout like this, and then you need to know what command what text we need to put here. So you need to open the readme file. So go to readme.md. And then here we need to type hello world in CPP and then line break. So I'm going to copy that. And then you can put this like this, or you can just maybe not put this like this. And then you can be maybe smarter, type std and line. So these are things that I expect you to know. I might cover it in the slides, but you should be familiar with these kind of stuff, at least a little bit. Should not be too foreigner. Okay, now I made that. I can run my make run. I should be in the correct folder. You see here on the 002 hello world folder, make run. Now this is going to build this for C++ using Clang plus, and then it's going to create a main file and then execute that main binary file that I created. If I look at it, it's here. I even don't need to use main to execute this. I can just type main.exe and then it executes that command for me. So that's my main.c CPP. Now I need to change test it. So main make test, not make test, not make test.tsh. And this is the output. So this is passing. Now it's time to push it to GitHub. So you type git status dash u, and this is the file that it changed. As you can see here, it says you're on branch main, and this is a local branch that you're using. Origin refers to your local address, and this is telling you that change is not staged. But this, by this, means that Git is seeing that you are making some changes, but you're not asking Git to keep an eye on it. So if you go and remove this, Git is not going to do anything. It's going to say, okay, I just saw you're making some changes, but I'm not keeping an eye on it. So think of staging in that sense. So I need to stage this first. So I can type git add main.cpp, or I can type git add dot to add everything that's in this folder. Since there's one change, so that would be it. I can also type git diff here, and that will show me that I removed an empty line and then I added this instead of that empty line. So that's a diff I created. So I can now type git add. Now, if I type git status dash u, now I see it says this is a staged and it's basically modified. So I can say git commit dash m. I can say completed CPP exercise. And then now it's committed. Now if I type git log, I will see, oh, this is my CPP exercise change, right? And this is my previous one, which is a C change. Few interesting thing about Git. So we are getting the Git discussion. Look at, sometimes people panic when this happens to them. So right now you see here, I have this, this is written here, and then everything is fine, right? Now, if I change to any of these previous saves, my code is going to go back to that time. Basically, whatever it was saved at that time, the code will look like that. So if I go back to, for example, here, right? This is the one that was created before making any changes to this GitHub repository. So if I type git checkout that specific hash, now I'm in that. And you see here, all my changes are back, are gone. You see here? And people panic. People say, oh, where did my code go? I wrote them, no, I spent so much time on it and my code is gone now. I'm in trouble. That's not true. So you basically went back in the past. So you are in the time that there were nothing in these files. So if I add them, I can figure out what was the hash for that. So I can go back to, for example, let's make this bigger. So I'm here right now. And I want to go back to the first one. I can type git checkout head. And head is basically the last commit that you made, and you're pointing to that. If I type git checkout head, or let's see, log. I got stuck here. So let me go back to my logs. This is the one that I want to jump into. For some reason, I'm not seeing it when I type git log. I think I have to type git log and verbose, but for now, git checkout here. And then I'm back to my CPP. Let's see how it looks like. Did I back? Yes, I'm back here. And this is my main CPP. This is my main.c. So if I type git status, let's see, where am I? Dash u, here. So it says git is detached. So how can I fix that? I want to go back to my git repo and to the head directory. So to the head branch. So how can I do that? And type git checkout main, and I'm back to the main directory. So I made a trick. Basically, I just checked out the main branch, and then I should be back to git status dash u, and then git log. And I'm pointing to the latest one, which is a completed CPP exercise. That's one way to do this. There are other ways. I'm not just maybe recalling them yet, but yeah, that's how we can just jump back and forth between the branches. So I'm going to push this, git push origin main. Sorry to making you confused, guys. Now, if I go back to my actions now, I've made the change. Now I see my changes are being pushed and being running on the GitHub actions. If I go here and extract this, make it expand this, I see it's installing Clang, and then it's going to install other stuff. Okay, let's let this thing finish, and then we go to the exorcism example. Okay, now I see both of them passed. And then I should go to my result, render result. I passed the first one, I passed the second one, and I got 100 out of 100. Okay, so that's how you can just work on the exercises. I hope this is clear. Now, next thing we want to do is working on the exorcism. So in exorcism, if you go to the local install exorcism locally, so let's go to the track, you need to create an account for them. And slow, so go to here, C++, and there is a link here, install C, installing locally or running locally. So if you go here, they have this instruction on to how to install this locally. On Windows, there's an exorcism CLI that you need to install. So if you go here, and you need to follow this basically. First, make sure you are in logged in into your exorcism account. Go to Windows, and then there's a proceed with manual install or install with CLI. I recommend you doing this because it's easier. And then you need to go to this GitHub repo, go to there, and just get this exorcism installer. Just download that. And then I have already done that. So if you run this, it will ask you where do you want to install it. Just install it wherever it just asks you for. So I put it in my C directory. Press next. It will just go ahead and install it. And it will add itself into the path folder. You see here, folder exorcism added to the path. So if you go to here, you can just I think Windows is what system variables. Yeah, edit the system environment variables. If you go to here and go to environment variables, and then if you look at these variables, one is the Pico SDK that we added. There should be one for exorcism here. I believe it adds it somewhere here. Yeah, I'm not sure where it does add that thing here, but if you know, let me know. So if it finishes, right? And then you press. Now, if you go to your command line, if you open your command prompt, from here, if you type exorcism, if you run it, you should see this. So this basically means that you installed exorcism on your machine. Okay, now how to use it in VS Code. So in VS Code, you need to, before going there, there are steps to finish this. So you say, okay, I installed it, you go next, and then there's something called configure CLI. So I'm going to show my actual CLI API key for the sake of demonstration, but after that I need to revoke it, basically invalidate it, because anybody who has that key, they can use my account. So you don't want to give out your CLI, your CLI key. So configure CLI, and this is a key that you're something like this format. This is for me. If you're logged into your account, you should get something like this. So it would be exorcism configure token and this thing. So you got just copy this. Make sure to definitely do this. Otherwise, you're not going to be able to get anything from their website. So you go to your command prompt, and then shift insert, and then exorcism configure. You run that, it will configure your exorcism. Basically, it's going to tell you where it's installing it and so on. There's a way in exorcism to define where to clone the repositories, but for now, let's not do that. Okay, and then go to yes, and then you have completed this. Now you want to clone this to your local machine. Now you want to get one of the app to do the first example exercise, right? If you guys have any questions, just let me know. You don't need to type it in the chat because I'm not checking the chat. So just shout it out. Go to C++ and for example, go to the first one. We are doing the hello world, right? Go to the first one. And then in here, you can go to Exorcism download. So get that. Go to VS Code. And then from here, I'm going to see where it's going to clone this thing. I'm going to paste that here. Exorcism download dash track and hello world. If I run that, it will say this is already there because I already have downloaded it, this one. So I'm going to remove it. Remove dash fr. And then it would be C users, my username, exorcism, CPP, and hello world. I'm going to remove that. Now, if I run that command again, another shortcut for your benefit is up arrow. So in shell, you have something called history. If you run the history, you will see the list of all the commands you ran in the past, right? These are all the things that I ran on this machine. So you can always press up arrow. It will tell you the first one. One more time, will give me the second one. One more time, it will give me the third one, and so on. So that's one way to do this. Another way is you write your history, and instead of just going up one at a time, if you know, for example, this one, right? This is very high. I can't just keep pressing up arrow. You can just get the history number, index number, exclamation, and then you type the number. So 586. I want to get this one. Instead of doing this and copying it, there, don't do any of these when you're in the Linux environment. So if I run that, it is going to run that command for me. Shortcut, right? So now I got it. I need to open this in my VS Code. So I type code, and then so since this is a bash. This is a bash environment. Everything is slash instead of the backslash. So C users, my username, exorcism, CPP, and I'm going to open this folder. Now it opens it in the new folder, in the new environment. And from here, I have my hello world, and this is my files that I need to work on. So since I have finished this once, probably I have the answer here. So when you open this, it would be goodbye Mars. We need to change it to hello, comma, space, world, exclamation. And that's all you need to know to do. Now, how to build this? This is using CMake. This is not using a pure make. We are in one or two sessions. We are going to actually learn about CMake. What does it actually do? This is just getting the file name from the folder. This is just setting the version of this minimum required version and so on. I'm not gonna go over this yet. So not let's wait for the class that we have for CMake. Now you have the CMake here ready. For CMake, you need to create a build folder. So I'm going to create a build folder. I type make dir or make directory. I call it build. Now I create the build folder. If you look at here, now I have my build folder here. It's outside of this, so I don't like it. I'm gonna remove it. Create it in the wrong folder. So if you have a folder and you want to remove it, you can't just type rm remove the folder because it will tell you this is a directory. It's not going to remove it. So to remove a directory, you need to put dash r for recursive. And now it's going to remove it. You see the build folder is gone. So I go to the project folder that I want to work on. So cd hello world. Now I'm there. I'm going to make directory build. Now I have my build folder. Now cd build folder. CMake, you will see that CMake generates a ton of artifacts. It creates a lot of folders and files and so on. So you don't want any of those to be pushed in your GitHub. So now that I'm in that folder, I type cmake, make sure you have set up your aliases correctly. So if you don't set up your aliases correctly, you need to type this whole thing. cmake dash g ming gw make files. But since I have done that, I can just type cmake and then dot dot. Dot dot means that go to the parent folder I might from my current folder. So if I don't know my current folder, I can always type pwd for print working directory. So I'm currently in this working directory. You see here, hello world build. And where is my cmake.txt file? It's here in the parent directory. So I'm in the build folder, I'm here, but my cmake list.txt is in the parent. So I'm going to point to that. So I type cmake dot dot. And if I run this, you see here, if everything is set up correctly, it will just generate the required build files. Now let's look at them. You see here, there are a ton of them. If I type, let me see if I have tree here. There's no tree here. But if you look at here, this is a, it created a file called make, folder called make files. Inside that, there are a lot of other things that it needs to execute your stuff and so on. So never push this to your GitHub repo. Make sure it's always in the build folder and ignore it in the Git. Okay. Sorry, if I missed your question, please ask your question. If I missed the chat question, so make sure to ask it if you have it. Don't let us hang around. Okay, so I created this build folder. Why I created this build folder? If I don't do that, you will see this is what's going to happen. So if I type git status, right now I don't have a git, so I want to show you a trick here. Git init, I'm going to create a GitHub repository. You don't need to do that, but let me not do that. Let me just go over the build process. So I created my build folder and I created my cmake stuff. So these are all the files it generated. Now I need to just run the make. And where is that make file list? It's here. See here? This is the auto-generated make file, similar to what I wrote for the previous example that you guys saw. But it has a lot more things in it. So it is auto-generated by cmake. So cmake basically is a language that generates build files like make files that make can use to build your application. You can see here, there are so many things in it. Okay, now from here, I can just easily type make. Why I can write make? Because I have this alias for make. If you don't have this alias, you won't be able to actually run the make. So type make, and this will actually build the application, and it will also test it as well. Unfortunately, my Windows machine is kind of slow, so it takes a while to finish this. So on the exorcism structure folders, if you look at here, there's a folder called the file that you need changed. You need to change. So this is the one. And this is using, as I mentioned, their claim is basically helping you to write idiomatic code. So they're using a namespace std. They're adding that namespace. There's a namespace called hello world. Inside that, they have this function which is hello and returns this keyword called hello world and returns it as a string. That's what it's returning. And if you go to the test folder, they have a bunch of tests written to check your code, basically. That's how it's going to work. And then there's a hello world header which has all the required headers in it. And that's the structure of their application, their program. So there is a help readme file. So if you don't like it to read it like this, you can always in VS Code click on this, and then you will see the formatted version of this. They're going over the running the test, passing the test, and how you can basically, they have incremental test setups. We go over these things when we get into the more advanced topics, but they have pound defined conditions to only include some parts of the test, so you can do test driven development. We will get to that discussion soon. So just know that this thing also exists. And there's a README file also. You can open that and you can also look at that one. So the README file has the instruction on what you need to do. And this README file is basically this, what you're seeing here is that thing. Okay, now that I finished it, you see here it says test passed. Now, the only thing I need to do is just push it to the exorcism. I type exorcism, I think it's a submit, and then the name of the file I need to submit, which is hello world. I'm in the build folder, right? So I don't have any hello world here. I have only the executable, which is this hello world. If I execute it, I see the output. So I need to push my source code. So I type exorcism, and then hello world.cpp, and it should be exorcism submit. And if you forget that, it should be somewhere around here. Exorcism submit. I remember I saw it somewhere, but it should be somewhere in there. Website. We'll find it soon. Let me go back to here. And if I type exorcism submit, hello world, if I press enter, I did it wrong. So I can type history and I can type grep exorcism. And it looks like I don't have it. So it's exorcism submit, right? Yes. So let's go down. It's exorcism submit and the file that you want to basically pass. So it would be shift insert and hello world.cpp. No files you submitted have changed since your last submission. Okay, it is actually trying to submit, but since I didn't change anything, it's not submitting it. I'm going to make a mistake here. So it would accept my submission. So go here. And I say hello world and hello CPP, right? Now I don't have that correct version. If I go to my build folder, now I can type make again. And then make is going to build my program. For some reason, it takes a while to do that. Not sure why. Okay, it failed. You see here, it's expecting to get hello world, but it's getting hello world and CPP, whatever. So I'm going to submit this wrong. So I'm going to say up, exorcism submit hello world.cpp. And if I do that, it should submit it, right? Your solution has been submitted successfully and go to this link to check it. So sure, I go there, open. And similar to what we had in the GitHub, they have the same thing, right? They run the CLI on their server and then they check and they say, okay, it failed. And then you submitted this thing basically. Now I need to go fix it. Go back. I'm going to make this hello world again. And go to my build folder. Run make again. Yeah, I think their CPP CMake has too much overhead. Takes a while on a bad computer to build. Okay, a few things to, okay, finished, right? Now I can type exorcism submit, right? I run it. Says the file you're trying to submit cannot be found. Why? Can somebody tell me why?
Because you're
You're
in
in
the
the
build
build
folder.
exactly. I'm in the build folder. Thanks. I go to the my parent folder, which is a CD dot dot, to go up a folder. And if I run that, now that file exists. It says solution has been submitted successfully, and you open it, and now I can check if it had been submitted correctly. Okay, it passed now. That's how it works. Okay, I spent the entire lecture class to just give you an introduction to the lab and a homework. So hopefully it's clear now to you guys. I hope I cleared all the questions we had. So if you have any other questions, let me know. We're at the end of the class. It's 8:14, and I'll be here for 15 minutes before the other class starts. If you don't have any questions, so that would be the end of our class. So you're released, and I'll see you on Saturday in person.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Professor.
You're welcome. Thanks.
Professor, I wasn't here the Monday. Did you give the YouTube playlist of the recordings?
Oh, sure. I will check if we have. So, yes, I will check if you have the recordings. I will push it to the YouTube. I will upload it to YouTube and then put the link to GitHub today, on Canvas today.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
Sure, you're welcome.